I would like to get back to doing the question and answers again. And I got some questions. This is a question I get very often. It is a changed life required for salvation? The quick answer is no. A changed life is not required for salvation. And the verse generally used to teach that a changed life is required is 2 Corinthians 5:17. It says in 2 Corinthians 5:17 through 18, "Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new." But then look at the next verse, and it says, "And all things are of God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of reconciliation." So if the new creature has to do with flesh and spirit, then these would be teaching sinless perfection, because in the next verse it says, "And all things are of God." And you have to admit, if you're honest, if you examine your life and look at it, you have to admit that everything you do is not of God. Your flesh does a lot of things that are not of God. And just like Paul said in Romans, he said, "I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing." So you see, the new creature does not have to do with the flesh. So it's mostly taught that if a person is saved, that they won't have a sinful lifestyle, since they are a new creature, right? And it's also taught that if they have a sinful lifestyle, that they have not truly repented. And they'll use Acts 26:20, where he says that they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance. Meaning, they need to do works that match somebody who is claiming to have repented. But the answer is, I'm a new creature when it comes to me being in Christ. My flesh is not in Christ, though. That's the key. Your flesh isn't in Christ. So if I live for the flesh, which isn't in Christ, my flesh isn't saved, it's not godly. So if I live for the flesh, I'm not going to have works meet for repentance. I'm not going to have works that you would expect a saved person to have. I'm not going to be showing that new creature that I am on the inside if I live for the flesh. And it's very possible for a Christian to live for the flesh, because Paul, talking to Christians in Romans 8:13, he says, "For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live." That verse plainly teaches that a Christian can live for the flesh. And because only a saved person can mortify the deeds of the body through the Spirit. Because only a saved person has the Spirit. But the verse also proves you can live for the flesh. So if you live for the flesh, then you aren't living for the Spirit. And if you're not living for the Spirit that's in you, then you're certainly not going to be acting like a new creature that you are in Christ. And you're certainly not going to have works meet for repentance. In other words, you're not going to have works that would match somebody who is going around, that ought to match somebody who's going around claiming to be saved. You see, Paul said, you know, "Let him that nameth the name of Christ depart from iniquity." We need to be living like you would expect somebody to live who's going around saying they're saved. But that the thing is, not everybody does that. Not everybody who's saved lives like they ought to. So if a Christian walks in the flesh, he's in great danger of committing any sin in the Bible. Galatians 5:16 says, "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh." You see that? Only a saved man can walk in the Spirit. So he's not talking to a lost person here. Walk in the Spirit. "This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that ye cannot do the things that ye would." So the flesh is going against the Spirit, and the Spirit is going against the flesh. That's that war that you got going on. And Paul talks about that in Romans as well. He says, "If you be led of the Spirit, you're not under the law." Now he's going to give you these works of the flesh. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like. So there's even more. He's just not naming them all. Of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So a Christian who walks in the flesh is in danger of committing any of these works of the flesh. And look at them: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness. There's your sexual sins. Idolatry, witchcraft even, hatred, drunkenness, murders. You know, somebody asks, you know, well, what about a murderer? What about a such and such? I mean, it's all listed there. If a person who's if a person's saved and they start walking in the flesh, they're in danger of committing any sin in the book. When someone claims a changed life is required for salvation, it will inevitably result in them double speaking and constantly contradicting themselves. So if you're teaching a changed life is required for salvation, you're going to notice this about yourself. And you're even going to be a little bit confused yourself, because sometimes you're going to say a person isn't saved if they have a certain lifestyle, or that they don't meet a certain lifestyle standard that you think a saved person should have. But then you're going to talk about a saint who's backslid at another time. You'll be talking about a person who's backslid. You'll be talking about a person who's gone back into his old ways. And if he's backslid or gone back into his old ways, then he's definitely not acting like a new creature. And he's definitely not doing works meet for repentance. So on one hand, you're saying a person can't be saved if they have a certain lifestyle that you don't think a saved person would have. But then on the other hand, you're saying somebody can be backslid, somebody can go back to their old ways, somebody can do such and such sin and still be saved. So which one is it? It can't be both. It's either a changed life required for salvation or not. If a changed life is required for salvation, and the Bible teaches that, then basically there can be no backslid person, because you're going to look at that backslid person and say, well, he's lost. Because he's not showing a changed life. So you don't judge a man's salvation by his works. If you say a changed life is required for salvation, you're causing everybody to, instead of looking to Jesus Christ as why they're saved, you're once again causing them to look at works again. Like, if I come to you and say, how do you know you're saved? And you say, well, I quit drinking, I quit smoking, I'm not an adulterer anymore, I don't do those things, that's the wrong answer. You need to know you're saved because there was a moment in your life where you believed on the Lord Jesus Christ from the heart. That's the right answer. And if you're constantly looking at how your performance is day to day on whether you're saved or not, that's going to hurt your assurance of salvation, because there is going to come a time in your life where you are not living right. So I only look at works to determine if I should fellowship with somebody, or if you're looking for a pastor, if you're looking for a deacon, you're looking for somebody to do something, teach a class or something. Obviously, you don't want a Christian who's living like the devil to have those positions. So you'd look at works in that situation. You would look at works to determine if you should fellowship with somebody, but not when it comes to determine if they're saved or not. Now, obviously, you can't help it. When you see somebody that's living like the world and living like the devil, automatically in your mind, you're going to think, well, that person's most likely not saved. You can't help that. That's the way it is. But when it comes right down to it, our works doesn't determine our salvation at all. The works, salvation and the works is a separate issue. Now, the next question is, what if you live a sinful life after salvation? The quick answer is, we're all going to die. If you live a sinful life after salvation, you're just speeding up the process. Because like that verse I already talked to you about, Romans 8:13, it says, for if you live after the flesh, ye shall die. Don't get me wrong, You may live to be 100 living like you're living, doing bad things. But if you've gotten rid of that pet sin, you may have lived to be 107. Ecclesiastes 7:17 says, "Be not overmuch wicked, neither be thou foolish. Why shouldest thou die before thy time?" You see? You're just shaving time off your life, living for the world. You also will lose your reign with the Lord in the kingdom. You'll still be there with Him, but you're not going to have as much reign. And that's what it's talking about back there when he's talking about the works of the flesh in Galatians 5. He said, "Those they which commit such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God." It didn't say that you're not saved or you're going to lose your salvation. It's talking about inheritance. You're not going to inherit some things. You're going to miss out on some inheritance. And he says in 2 Timothy 2:12, "If we suffer, we shall also reign with Him. If we deny Him, He also will deny us." If you're not suffering for the Lord in this life, turning things down, turning down temptation, turning down things of this world, you're not suffering for the Lord, you're not going to reign with Him. He isn't denying our salvation, He's denying your reign. So you can lose rewards, you can lose your reign, you can shave time off of your life, but sinning after salvation does not affect the salvation itself, because once again, it's your flesh that's doing the sinning, not the real you, the new creature inside who's saved, that's doing the sinning. So you have to separate those things, this flesh versus the spirit. You know, you got your new man on the inside that's not sinning. You got the old man on the outside that is sinning. And Paul breaks it down in Romans 7:14 through 25. He says, "For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin." Now look at this battle he's got going on. He says, "For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I." You see, that should remind you of something. The things that you know you're supposed to do, that there's something in you that wants to do it, the right thing, you have a hard time doing it. He says, "If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Now then it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me." He said it's no more me doing it. It's not the new creature in me doing it. It's my flesh, the sin that dwelleth in me that doing it. He says, "For I know that in me, that is, in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing." Your flesh isn't good. You remember that back there in 2 Corinthians, it said, "And all things are of God." Your flesh is not a God. Your flesh wants to do wrong. He says, "For to will is present with me." He wants to do right. "But how to perform that which is good I find not. For the good that I would I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do." He's saying the good I want to do, I struggle with doing it, and the evil that I don't want to do, I end up doing it, because it's his flesh. "Now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. I find in the law that when I would do good, evil is present with me." He says, "For I delight in the law of God after the inward man," that new creature, that's who delights in the law of God. "But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin which is in my members." Now look what he says, "O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death?" That's not the new creature. That's the flesh. The wretched man. That's not the new man. That's the old man. And whichever one you feed the most, that's the one that's going to come out the most. If you feed the flesh is going to be the one you're walking in. You feed the spirit, you're going to walk in the spirit. Now, the next question is, well, to answer that question, what happens if you sin after salvation? Well, you don't lose the salvation. You're just going to die quicker than you would have, and you're going to lose rewards, and you're going to lose fellowship with the Lord. Fellowship is not salvation. That's just a closeness with God, where you're constantly talking to Him, constantly reading the Bible, constantly praying. You're not going to be close to Him anymore. You're going to lose a lot of things, and there's consequences to it, but you're not going to lose your salvation. So the last question is, can you lose your salvation in any way? The answer is no. Think about it like this. Can you change the fact that you were born physically to your mother? No, you can't change that fact. I know sometimes you might say, I wish I was never born, but you can't make that happen. You can't go back and change the fact that you were born, right? It's like that with your spiritual birth. You see, salvation is, at your salvation, a birth took place. He didn't let you choose to be born in your physical birth, but He does give you the choice to be born again. He gives you the chance to be born that second time. And if you made the choice to be born again, nothing can change the fact that you are born again spiritually into the family of God. You can't go back and get unborn again. I've heard, I went to a holiness church for a while, and the pastor would talk about getting reborn again. And that doesn't make sense. Because just like Nicodemus said, he didn't understand the Lord, but he made a point. He said, I can't go back into my mother's womb and be reborn. He thought it was talking about, the Lord was talking about a physical birth. And it's like that with the spiritual birth. You can't go back and get reborn again spiritually. You already been born spiritually. So, and nothing can change that fact. What's done is done. You're in the family of God. I know you want to lose your salvation really bad. I'm sorry. You got to go to heaven. You got to go be with the Lord. I'm sorry. But just like that conversation there between the Lord and Nicodemus in John 3, 3 through 8, that's very telling, and it really helped you understand your salvation when you realize salvation, a birth took place at your salvation. You got born again. You were also spiritually circumcised. In Colossians 2:11 through 13, it says, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, and putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. When it said made without hands, that shows that it's a spiritual circumcision. The fact that you've been circumcised spiritually when you got saved proves you can't lose it. And what happened with the spiritual circumcision was your soul, which is saved now and righteous, was cut from your flesh, which is not saved and it's evil. So when a saved man chooses to walk in the flesh after he's saved, since he's been spiritually circumcised and his soul was cut loose from his flesh, those sins of the flesh don't touch the soul. They don't contaminate the soul. It only has to do with the flesh. So his flesh will die because of sin, but the soul will not die. Also, remember the fact that the soul has the imputed righteousness of Jesus Christ applied to it, and God is no longer imputing your unrighteousness to your soul anymore, according to Romans 4. Just like it said, blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. Not only did He give you the imputed righteousness, He impute Jesus' righteousness to you, He gave you Jesus' perfect, sinless, spotless record and put that on your record, on your soul, but He does not impute any unrighteousness to your soul anymore. So it goes uncontaminated. It's been cut loose from the flesh. You're born again. There's nothing you can do about it. But those are just some quick questions. If you have some more questions, I want to make a new email so you can send those to it, because my other email, I can't get into it half the time for some reason, and it's constantly a bunch of junk there. So I'm going to make a new one and make it more organized. That way I can get to these question and answers much easier.